So today, on the occasion of the Rare Disease Day, we will try to show some of the examples of how we have been working on rare diseases for the last 20 years at IGIB. And this is a specific study I would kind of describe, where we have been able to work on a rare neurodegenerative disorder called spinocerebellar ataxia in Indian population, and it has provided us a paradigm for understanding diseases and disease deconvolution. So we work in the Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology, and one of the major focuses as to how to utilize the genomics technologies to be able to understand diseases. Just to kind of briefly introduce the subject of genomics to people who might not be so aware, is that all the living organisms in the world are made up of the same four letters, which can be sort of compared with the alphabets in English, and these are called as nucleic acids. And if you thread these nucleic acids, then it creates words which are DNA, and a string of DNA is what comprises genes, which could be analogous to sentences, and these sentences can be threaded to form a chapter of a book, and this would be analogous to chromosomes. And the entire book comprising of all these chapters is what comprises the genome. So we actually have 23 pairs of chromosomes inherited, one copy inherited from each of the parents, and the letter is about 3 billion from each of the parents. So this is what is called as genome. And the science of the study of genomes is what is genomics. So coming to it, that all of us, though we have the same genome, does our DNA actually change, and what could be the consequence of the change? So for example, I again give an analogy that if you start with a color, and then you actually have a substitution or a kind of a change from the spelling of color C-O-L-O-U-R to C-O-L-O-R, which would be like a deletion, and that would still have a meaning. But then if you again have an insertion, it might make another word which does not have a meaning, and nature does not tolerate that, and then it might again substitute it for another word like cooler, which would have a meaning, but it would be a little different from color. Or you could have other kinds of substitutions where the same word can actually change to another word through a substitution and an insertion like calorie. So over a period of time, such kind of changes can happen. And what I've shown over here is, like, for example, then you can have deletion, you can have inversions, you can have fusions, and you start with a word like color, and you actually end up in something like cool look. So this is what has happened to our genomes also, because we've evolved in Africa nearly 100,000 years back, and with the same genome, as we moved and we adapted to different conditions, our genome went through certain changes, and some of these changes have been tolerated. That's why we and it has given rise to phenotypes, but some changes could lead to certain kinds of deleterious functions, and that would lead to diseases. For example, now it is catalogued that there are nearly 8,000 rare diseases which are a consequence of such kind of changes, which are not good for the functioning of a genome. So now, how does one go about doing genetic studies, or how does one try to understand which are the variations which are likely to cause genetic diseases? And in a population which is as diverse as India, how does one go about it? Because if you see, the Indian population is like a global melting pot of human diversity, where There have been settlements in different time periods. There have been invasions in different parts from different parts of the world, and also our country has many linguistic lineages, many morphological meaning. The population can be classified on the basis of morphological basis also, And we have thousands of communities, many endogamous groups, and many functioning languages. And with this has actually created a large diversity in the Indian population. And as a result of which, it might be possible that if there might be some genetic disorders which are more prevalent in certain populations, the kind of dosage of drugs which are needed might be dependent on the kind of natural variations which they have acquired, etc. So in order to be able to carry out genetic studies, one first needs to understand the diversity, and maybe then you might be able to sort of start developing these tests for genetic disorders. So to be able to do that, way back in 2002, we initiated this project called the Indian Genome Variation Project. The idea was, if we could understand how populations of India are related to each other and how this relation has a bearing on genetic diseases or prevalence of variations which are linked to genetic diseases. So this was the first comprehensive genetic landscape of India from the perspective of genetic diseases, and the map which is shown over here actually indicates how populations are related to each other. So if there is a similar color in a particular kind of in this linguistic map, this indicates that these populations are more closely related to each other. So as you can see, that there doesn't seem to be a homogeneous color in any of these grids in the map, which indicates that language is not the criteria by which you can say that people who speak the same language are genetically related to each other. There are many more things beyond that, and we were able to sort of understand as to how amongst these diverse populations, Indian population cluster into five major groups, and these are dependent on all the three criteria as to the ethnicity, the linguistic background, as well as the geography. Now, how is this information useful? So you can see there are some examples given. For example, there is a variation like APOBEC3B which has been linked to susceptibility to infection, and the prevalence of a particular variation differs amongst the Indian population. And you can see that this prevalence, if you overlay it with malaria endemicity map, then there are certain differences with respect to certain geographical regions. For example, there is a very highly endemic region for malaria, and a particular allele of APOBEC, which is the insertion allele, seems to be higher in this population. So one can actually use these maps to be able to understand the likely kind of protection from because of these variations, because people are surviving in this region and maybe something in these variations have something to do with it. So like that, we have been able to use this map for many kinds of studies. For example, we identified a gene for high altitude adaptation or response to a particular drug in a particular population. This is what the basic landscape tells us. But this has also been useful in other kinds of studies, which I would be coming to a little while from now. And this is with regards to the rare diseases which we are talking about. So in the recent times, people have been using this word called precision medicine, which is nothing but if we understand our genome in a greater detail, then we might be able to have intervention possibilities right from when we plan a baby to understanding who is at risk, which could allow us to identify mechanisms of prevention of diseases, or also at the level of treatment. So this precision medicine is also plays an important role in management of rare diseases, because rare diseases have a large social impact and economic impact. They cumulatively affect around 70 million people in India and 300 million worldwide. Though it is called as rare, because maybe 4 in 10,000 people have a particular rare disease, but the combined prevalence of all rare diseases still comprise 2 to 5% of the population. And because of the rarity of the disease, there is a general lack of awareness lack of easily available and affordable system for genetic testing, and also an incomplete understanding of what is the mutational spectrum of the disease. Because of all this, on an average, a patient nearly takes 7 years to be able to be diagnosed for a rare disease, and that causes a lot of problems in terms of recurrent hospitalizations, and if the disease is degenerative in nature, early understanding might have some kind of rehabilitation options, but those are not available if there is no comprehensive system for testing of genetic diseases in India. So moving on, I will try to describe what we have been doing in one such rare disease in Indian population, and this has provided us an insight into how, if we want to set up rare disease studies in the Indian population for evolving genomics aided diagnostics or for translational research, how do we go about it? So the disease which I am mentioning is cerebellar ataxia. This is a neurological disorder which primarily affects the cerebellum and its efferent and efferent connection, and it results in motor movement in coordination. So people would have movement difficulties, which is called as gait ataxia, tremor or slurring of speech, nystagmus, etc. And there are variable associations of neurological disorders. So there is no one kind of a feature which will define ataxia. There is a syndromic kind of manifestation, and the disease frequency is around 4.8 to 13.8 per 100,000. Now the disease has a variable age of onset, so some of them could be pediatric or some would be adult onset. And once you have the disease, it's very progressive, and it's very debilitating, and people would be wheelchair bound very early, or it would also depend upon the kind of ataxia the person suffers from. So what are the challenges in the genetics of cerebellar ataxias? There are different kinds of things which kind of confound diagnosis or also poses a problem during genetic testing, because the nature of mutation in different ataxias could vary. There could be repeats which could repeat expansions which could contribute to the pathogenesis of disease. There could be variability at the single nucleotide level, which is called as SNP, which could contribute to the disease. Or there could be large chunks of DNA which gets deleted or expanded, which could be causative in nature. Now, each of these mutations present with different attributes. For example, if there is a repeat expansion, then it gives rise to a particular phenomena of anticipation, wherein in subsequent generation, the length of the repeat increases during transmission, and the length of this repeat expansion is also correlated in many cases with severity of the disease and earlier onset. So as a result of which, the first generation with a smaller length of repeat might get the disease at a much later age, but during subsequent generation, because of lengthening of the repeat, the disease onset will be much earlier, and also the severity is much more in the younger cases. Secondly, the same variation might have differences with respect to penetrance. So everybody with the mutation might not get the disease, or there could be differences in expressivity, which means that the extent of phenotypic manifestation might differ even with the same variation, and also there could be differences in progression of disease. This could be because of modifier genes which could be working in conjunction with the causative mutations, and also the copy number variations are linked to quantitative differences also in expression. Secondly, the age of onset can vary with these repeats, and more than that, there is all the variability in all the phenotype could also be that the same gene contributes to differences in phenotypes, or different genes contribute to the same phenotype, or maybe different genes could also have overlapping phenotypes. As a result of which, for a clinician, it is very difficult to kind of recommend which gene to be tested because of the phenotypic heterogeneity. There could be differences with respect to population. So the same mutation in a different population might present with a little with differences in phenotypes. There could be differences in prevalence of ataxia in different populations, and also the mode of inheritance can vary. Some of the ataxia genes have autosomal dominant, some have autosomal recessive, some are mitochondrial, some are X-linked, and some are sporadic with no known member, meaning it occurs only in one or two members, but not it does not run in the family. Now, to this date, there are large number of mutations reported. For example, in 16 conventional ataxias, 154 mutations are reported. There are 12 dynamic repeat mutations, 7 in which the regions have been mapped but the genes are not known. Then there are around 1900 mutations in 26 genes which could be associated with autosomal recessive ataxia. So as a result of which, for a doctor, it's very difficult recommend what kind of genes to be tested, and at the clinic, it actually becomes difficult as to what test to do. As a result of which, not only the time to diagnosis is more, but also it increases the cost of diagnosis. So people have been trying to evolve various methods to reduce the to be able to kind of develop an algorithm for testing ataxias. So they would be various pointers to it. For example, certain ataxias follow a particular inheritance pattern, or there could be certain ones which are X-linked or have mitochondrial. So these would have a little bit of variability. For example, mutations, if they happen in DNA repair genes, are mostly linked to autosomal recessive ataxias or metabolic ataxias, or also autosomal recessive in nature. Depending on the kind of the mutations, for example, the repeat expansions always happen for in the coding region, then they are CAG repeat and cause polyglutamine expansions. There are some CAG repeat expansions reported in the 5 prime UTR of the genes, like SCA12. Some are in the 3 prime UTR, like SCA10. And then there are conventional mutations which are mostly in the coding regions of the genes. This is a typical case of trinucleotide repeat instability, in which normal individuals also have these repeats and they are polymorphic, but the range is restricted to a particular threshold. Only when the repeat cross a particular threshold, then the repeats become unstable, and during subsequent transmission, the length of the repeat increases and the onset of the disease also becomes earlier. Now, when people have studied many of these repeat loci, there are certain kinds of features which are pointers to what are the kind of alleles which are more prone to expansion. For example, it has been shown that if there are longer repeat lengths, then those are the ones which are more prone to expansion. And you can, if you have variations linked to larger alleles, by looking at these variations, you could predict that which are the haplotypes which are likely to be unstable. The other thing is that many of these repeats have stabilizing interruptions in healthy people, but if they are expanded, then the interruptions are lost. And one can also trace or identify whether such kinds of alleles with loss of interruptions occur in a population, even in a smaller length, and those could be the kind of pool or reservoir for expansion prone chromosomes. So, using a population-based approach, looking at polymorphisms, one can also kind of predict whether there is a likelihood of a particular expansion to be more in the populations. These repeats, if they are causing the disease, then they can be detected by a PCR based method, where the this is a method called gene scan, where this is a normal allele, and if there is an expansion, you get an added site. So what you do is you actually do a PCR with a fluorescently labeled primer, and the expanded repeat will have a larger size, and you could detect it in the automated sequencer. You could also sequence in the repeat region to be able to assess whether repeats are continuous stretches of repeats you get, and that's the way you detect the expansion. And the way to detect point mutations are by standard sequencing method. Like here, there is a heterozygosity with respect to this GT, or you could also use genotyping methods to be able to also distinguish which allele is present, and this is a high throughput method of detecting mutations, provided you know that there are a large number of people who need to be tested. Now coming to the phenotypic and genetic heterogeneity, what also is seen is that supposing there are two genes A and B which are implicated in ataxia, the gene A can cause a phenotype 1 and another phenotype, which also would result if there is a mutation in gene B, but it will come with an additional phenotype. So this is what is meant by phenotypic heterogeneity. The other thing is that even the same gene can actually present itself with different kinds of ataxia. For example, there's this gene called synataxin. It could have mutations all over, which would result in this gene disease called ataxia ocular apraxia 2. But if there are mutations at specific sites in the same gene, then it would lead to another kind of disease called amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. And if there are even more specific mutations, then it can present with neuropathy and ataxia. And then there could be other mutations in the gene where it is ataxia, but then it presents with tremor-like symptoms. There could be other genes which could also converge to same kind of phenotype. So you can see the kind of phenotypic heterogeneity and the kind of genetic heterogeneity. It is, unless you have a clear-cut idea or you of the mutation, you might not be able to arrive at a correct diagnosis for the disease. And also, if you diagnose it, then the same gene might have to be tested in different places to be able to have a genotype to phenotype correlation. So we've been studying ataxia for the last 20 years in India, in the Indian population. This has been a collaboration with All India Institute of Medical Sciences, which is a tertiary referral center, and over the course of last 20 years we have studied over 5,000 families, and AIIMS now runs a unique ataxia clinic where patients from all over the country approach for testing of ataxias. In our experience, what we have observed is that nearly 50% of the families can be explained by a few trinucleotide repeat expansions, and the prevalence of these expansions also differ. For example, SCA12 is the most prevalent, followed by SCA2, SCA1, and then there are rare cases of SCA3, SCA7 and FRDA. The other ataxias which are prevalent in different populations are not reported. So we could, because of this, say that maybe by a limited number of tests we can explain nearly 50% of the cases. What we have also additionally observed is that the unique prevalence of these ataxias in specific populations are because of founders and the endogamous nature of our population, as a result of which we have identified genetic markers which are uniquely linked to only expanded chromosomes, and this gives us a way to screen for such founders in other populations of the country and try to see whether which of the other populations could also be at risk of the disease. So over the period of last few years, we have been able to trace founders of pretty much all the prevalent ataxias in the Indian population, and also correlated with their prevalence in specific Indian populations. So these are some of the papers. For example, we identified a founder haplotype for Machado-Joseph's disease in Indian population, which otherwise was thought to have a origin in the Portuguese population. But our study showed that the founder haplotype might have migrated from India to Portuguese Azores Island, and from there it would have spread across to different world populations. The other unique example is of SCA12, which is nearly unique to Indian population and also to a particular community traced back to Haryana. Now, these informations are useful for clinicians because in a clinical setting, if they know that there are certain populations which are at risk, they are able to arrive at a clinical diagnosis faster, and also can recommend a limited number of tests by which we could explain the diseases. So this is an example of SCA12 in the Indian population. The disease is restricted primarily to this population, and we have been able to identify a founder haplotype which is unique to the patients and not seen in any controls. We have studied them in the Indian genome variation data also, and we find that this founder haplotype is only unique to this population or this community. Similar to the SCA12, there's another disease called SCA7, where we've studied 22 patients from 9 families, and we again identify that there is a unique founder for this disease, and that founder chromosome is only restricted to the population in the Indian genome variation panel from which these subjects are derived. So that again kind of reinforces that if you identify haplotypes which are linked to disease alleles, then you might be able to kind of assess its frequency in different populations of the country and might be able to make risk prediction maps, as a result of which specific populations only needed to be tested first for particular sets of ataxias, and then it could be screened for other ataxias if the explanation for the disease is not adequate. So based on this, we've been able to develop a genetic screening paradigm of ataxias. For example, if it's autosomal dominant, then we know what kind of tests are recommended. If these are not there, then we go for another panel to test. And then if they are present, then our diagnosis stops there. If they are not, then we screen for other ataxias depending on the age or etc. of what is known about the known diseases. If it's sporadic in nature, then depending on the age of manifestation, we could then again test a specific loci, and that way, and if it is autosomal recessive, then the first test we do is for Friedreich's ataxia. If that is not so, then we again test for other ataxias, and then if we are not able to explain through the known panel, then we resort to exome sequencing. So by this way, we could exclude out a number of tests which needn't be done and arrive at a test faster. So we've been now able to also develop a multiplex PCR panel which allows us to rapidly screen a large number of loci at one time, and which reduces the cost and increases the throughput of testing. So this test is now provided through this GOMET platform of our institute, which actually leverages all the kind of genetic studies we are doing in different diseases, and we provide the test free of cost to patients who are referred through our clinical network. And in this way, we have been able to make the tests which we have developed accessible and affordable in different parts of the country. And the GOMED program is now provides tests for a number of genetic disorders, where movement disorders, and that is the spinocerebellar ataxias, is one of them. the way, so this kind of initiative has also allowed people to in far off communities who've not been knowing what disease they suffer from to approach us, and by this we actually identified a particular community in Buldana district where nearly 200 families are impacted by one of these ataxias, which is MJD, and we've been able to screen the families, a few family, and we find that it's the same mutation across the whole population, and and this has been very debilitating because large number of families and large number of people are affected in each family, and the community has come forth to kind of request if more number of people can be screened so that they would be able to make decisions earlier than when the when they actually, before they pass on the variations to the next generation, in the absence of knowledge of them carrying this mutation, and these issues get highlighted. But before we embark on such large scale screening, we also need to take care of ethical issues for effectively delivering diagnostic in these populations, and that is a major consideration, and we are trying to see how we can take it forward. Now coming to the uncharacterized ataxia, which nearly comprises 50% of the cases which are referred, we wanted to know whether genomics can help explain some of them, so that we would be able to explain the genetic cause of disease in much more number of cases. So we started this with a proof of concept study where there were a large number of uncharacterized ataxias, from where we selected three such families, one with different phenotypes. One of them was like Friedreich's ataxia but did not have the Friedreich's ataxia mutation. Another one was infantile, and the third one had seizures and developmental delay and hearing along with ataxias. So these three families, we thought that we will sequence their exomes, that is the coding part of the we carried out exome sequencing in these families using the next generation sequencing platform. And primarily what is done over here is that we have these uncharacterized cases, we carefully select the cases, isolate their DNA, take the routine family history, clinical details, etc. Then take them through whole exome sequencing, where basically we fragment the DNA into small parts and capture the exonic regions and do a sequencing in this massively parallel sequencer, which is the HiSeq platform over here. After we get sequences, we analyze them and take them through various kinds of quality filters to be able to kind of remove the variations which might not be informative, and then assess the subset which follows a particular segregation pattern for they're likely to be pathogenic and clinically significant. So this is the workflow which is primarily followed in all exome sequencing. So we took our samples through such kind of similar process, and we in the process we get a large number of non-synonymous and splice site changes, but then we apply a disease model whether the mutation segregates in a homozygous recessive or heterozygous manner, and then prioritize the mutations which segregate in such a manner. Then we overlap it with large number of databases to be finally arrive at a limited set of variations which could be potentially pathogenic. So when we kind of tested this out in the three families that I mentioned, we one of them had consanguinity, and so we actually had carried out homozygosity mapping and identified a particular region, but there were 400 genes, and when we did exome sequencing we try to first see whether there are any likely genes in the regions which have segregated in our earlier linkage analysis. Similarly, we carried out homozygosity mapping in this which had which looked like it followed a recessive inheritance, again identified nearly 25 genes. So exome sequencing allowed us to resolve what are the likely genes, or the third family also where it segregated in a particular manner. And we, after all the filtering criteria, we were able to identify a novel missense mutation in one gene called C10ORF2 in this infantile onset ataxia. The second one was a compound heterozygote in a variation in a gene called CLN6, and the third one was a frameshift mutation in a gene called Saxin. So to be able to sort of assess whether the mutation is likely to be causative, we carried out Sanger sequencing of the unaffected and the parents, and as you can see over here, the affected is homozygous for frameshift mutation. So there are three C's which is not there in the unaffected, and the carrier parent is heterozygous. So this gene, nearly 90 mutations have been reported in this gene, and it is also known to cause autosomal recessive ataxia. So we think that this could be a causative. In the second one also, you could see that the affected one has a homozygote, has a G here. The unaffected is has A allele, and the carrier parent has both the allele as heterozygous condition. So this is we looked up the literature, and this gene has also been associated with a variety of neurodegenerative phenotype. The third was an interesting case of CLN6, which has been linked to this disease called ceroid lipofuscinosis. And this was a compound heterozygote where the mutations, two sets of variations were inherited from mother and father, so that the patient was a compound heterozygote and the parents were heterozygous for one allele and homozygous at the other. So this is the affected child, and these are the parents' alleles, right? So now we checked up, we went and looked at the other reported mutations for the C10ORF2. So then you can see that this has a large number of mutations reported, and depending on where the mutations are, it presents with either autosomal dominant progressive external ophthalmoplegia, or there are regions where if there are mutations, then it is reported with recessive ataxia. So the mutation map to the region of ataxia, and we think that this is a causative mutation in this family. In case of ceroid lipofuscinosis, though all these patients do not traditionally go to a neurologist because they have more of metabolic symptoms, but if you go to the omen description of disease, then ataxia is also, meaning the features which were reported in omen also present in the family which came to us, and it gives us a reasonable confidence to say that this is one of the genes which could be linked to ataxia. The third one, if you see, again, this is the symptoms which are reported in omen for these disease are also shared with our family. And so when you have the mutation and when you have overlapping symptoms, then again there is a reasonable chance to say that the mutation in this family is in this gene actually causes ataxia. So based on these information, we could actually introduce three more genes to the ataxia panel for screening in the Indian population. And this also told us another important aspect, that one would need to actually go to the database which are linked to these mutations in any genes which come out after sequencing and try to see whether ataxia is also one of the subphenotype, then you could include that in the screening panel for ataxias. So the learning from this pilot study tells us that Indian families can actually be a rich resource for identifying mutations linked to ataxia. Mutations of known ARCA genes may be more prevalent than expected. That is, all the variations we detected were novel variations, but they were in reported ataxia genes. So you could actually have a targeted panel created where you could screen for novel mutations. Inclusion of exome sequencing could help detect or dissect the genetic basis of uncharacterized ataxias. And identification of causal genes would need revisiting of clinical phenotypes at implicated lesi. So it has to be an iterative exercise where you have a mutation, you go back to the clinical phenotype, and then you try to sort of iteratively decide whether the genotype-phenotype correlation. So targeted sequencing of genes identified in syndromes where ataxia is a subphenotype may also increase the diagnostic yield in ataxia. Moving on, because of our long-standing relation with AIIMS, and we've been able to also move forward for using this resource towards translational research. This ataxia resource, which we have built over the period of last 20 years, has also become an important resource for translational research study. So our group has recently demonstrated that using patient-specific cell lines, they could actually screen synthetic transcription elongation factors and see whether they can ameliorate the cellular phenotypes which are in Friedreich's ataxia. So this is featured in Science. And just because we've been studying Friedreich's ataxia for a long time period, we could actually have the cell lines to be able to test this observation independently, and this was done in collaboration with University of Wisconsin. We've also been actually creating patient derived cell line to understand mechanisms of pathogenesis to be able to identify points for intervention, either for management of disease or maybe in future it could be used for drug repurposing. For example, SCA12, which is unique to India, we've been able to differentiate them through PBMCs to neuronal cell lines, and using genomics technologies, primarily transcriptome sequencing in these neuronal lines, we could detect certain signatures which could be implicated in pathogenesis of disease. And these are the transcriptome signatures suggest that there could be rearrangement in immune response pathways, which could contribute to progression of diseases. So just to summarize, over the last many years, we've been able to develop the largest repository in India of ataxia, which has enabled us to map at-risk population and also understand the origin and mechanism of mutations in the Indian population. Not only that, we've been able to discover novel genes of ataxia. So these are further studies which we have carried out on more uncharacterized ataxias using NGS. We've been able to add another set of genes to the the screening panel of ataxia. And not only that, this resource has also become important for translational research. So the future prospects what we could sort of envision for future is how we could focus on making these more affordable, accessible and available to all. We demonstrate by the SCA study that this can be done for many rare diseases in the country, but this requires creation of national registries and electronic health records for continuous review and refining clinical decisions, because once we tell the clinicians about the genetic tests, then they can go back and revisit their the clinical phenotypes, and the next time they become much more better at suggesting or recommending appropriate tests to be performed in the clinic, as a result of which the turnaround time for diagnosis might reduce, and our specificity, or meaning the success rate, is likely to increase. We could evolve diagnostic algorithms that could explain substantial number of cases through limited genetic testing. Using next generation sequencing, we could identify novel mutations which could add to the diagnostic panel. And now there are methodologies where for example, in patient-derived cell line, we could assess which are the alleles which are functionally deleterious. And these panels or these patient-specific cell lines could also be used for future translational research, for example, drug repurposing, cell-based therapies, genome editing, etc. But all these also would mean that we have to handle the ethical, legal and social issues before implementing this in large scales, because rare genetic disorders come with a lot of all these issues, many of them because some are late onset, and some if they are incompletely penetrant and we do not, we might be giving a wrong diagnosis. So I would like to end here with acknowledging the research team. The project was primarily envisioned by Professor Brahmachari and Professor Satish Jain, who was the professor in AIMS, who thought that such kind of testing need to be evolved in India. During that time, there were not many places in India where genetic testing of diseases were carried out. So we initiated ataxia during that time. I joined as a scientist fellow, but then with the joining of Professor Achal Srivastava, we took it forward, and then we have a new member who has been working with us from 2005 or 6 onwards. He was a PhD student but graduated to become a clinician scientist, and now he's developed the entire translational aspect of this research. So the success of this has been because of induction of clinicians into our research program that allowed us to iteratively look at genetic tests from the genotype-phenotype perspective. And we've had a huge number of PhD students who have contributed to this effort, along with our collaborators and NIMHANS collaborators, where we actually have got a chance to validate whatever we developed in AIMS, and financial support from CSIR and DBT.